Well, it is time to come down from space. Let's land this space shuttle on this beautiful Friday afternoon and talk about communication and see if we can find a way to take complex information and make it easily understood by everyone around us. Now, I have to tell you, as I was preparing for this session, I was thinking back to the moment when I realized that you could take really complex things and find a way to make other people understand it, that this was possible. So let me paint the picture for you. It's 2007, and I am sitting in my fourth week of stats class at Queen's. Now, this was not my first go-round with stats. I took stats in my undergrad 9 years previous, and it was not an easy ride. I'm not going to lie to you. That was a tough topic for me. In fact, I think the only way I got through it was a lot of late nights in the residence rec room with a ton of coffee and a guy by the name of Danny Jardine. I'm fairly certain I still owe him a beer from all the help he gave me getting through stats class. So here I am again, second time round, sitting through stats. But this time is different. I'm getting it. Not only am I understanding the math behind the stats, but I'm figuring out how and when to apply these formulas. It's really quite different. Now, you might argue, okay, you're older, you're more mature, you were paying more attention. I got to tell you, I was pretty studious undergrad. I'll tell you, there were two things that stood out for me that were different. The first was the professor. The language that he used to explain the concepts we were learning, the examples he provided were so relevant to me in my life at that time, and I was understanding it. Now, the second thing that I would highlight is the textbook. Yes, I am using a textbook, a stats textbook, no less, as best-in-class communication, but it was phenomenal. Again, the language was easily understood. The examples given were relevant, and 13 years later, I still have this stats textbook. I'm going to give a shout out to Andy Field because I suspect he's never gotten a shout out on a webinar before. I still have this textbook, not because I've used stats or SPSS really since then, but because I can't get rid of it. It truly represents this notion that we have a responsibility as communicators to effectively convey the message we're trying to teach. And that's what we're going to spend today on. I promise it won't be as hard as stats class, although I trust many of you flew through it with flying colors. My hope, though, is that you find one adjustment that you can make to your approach, whether you're sharing study results, research results, whether you're communicating return to play decisions, or you have a new therapy you want to try with an athlete. If you can find one new approach or a tweak that you can make today, I think we've accomplished a great Friday afternoon session. So we're going to tackle this topic in three sections. First section is we're going to take a look at the reasons for ineffective communication. Why do we sometimes struggle as experts? Because let's be honest, everyone on this call is an expert in something, and that's where you spend the bulk of your time. So what are the reasons we are ineffective in our communication? Then we'll look at some important considerations as you go into preparing for your communication. And finally, we'll look at the tools, some really practical tools you can use to build your story, I would say. And hopefully this fits in line really well with Bob's talk, which was so interesting. We will have questions today, so please put those in the Q&A box and we'll make sure we get those answered. So, many of you have heard this quote before, often attributed to George Bernard Shaw with a little dispute. I think if we start here in our journey, we can see that communication doesn't take place just because you told somebody something. Let me repeat that. Communication doesn't take place just because you told somebody something. And this is often a big part of the issue in what we need to, what our job is in communication. We make the assumption that we're done, check the box. So I have a question for you. Whose responsibility is it to ensure that communication has actually taken place? Now, I would argue that it is ours as the communicator and ours alone. It is our responsibility. And I think if we shift our mindset as we think about communication and we shift to believing that we have responsibility for this role, we're 80% of the way there. But the rest we're going to talk about today is just the last 20%. Okay, so let's start with why it's so hard. First and foremost, for this particular crew, I have no doubt, is that we know too much. We know too much about the topic. We're experts in the scenario. There's a term called the curse of knowledge. Now, it was coined by three economists back in 1989. They were writing about having knowledge in a business transaction, in a purchase, found it was disadvantageous for that. But Chip and Dan Heath, who wrote a book called Made to Stick, also highlighted the curse of knowledge. And the big problem when we know too much is that we make assumptions about what our audience knows. We actually don't have great insight into where their knowledge starts and where it stops. So we often make the mistake of either jumping in at the wrong point, right? And we've lost them from the beginning. Or maybe we take shortcuts in our explanation. We make assumptions about what they do know. So we make those shortcuts, again, forgetting that they don't have the same intimate knowledge as we do. You know, we may know the biomechanics of a volleyball serve, and as such, it's really hard for us to put ourselves in the minds of a 10-year-old as we teach them to hold their hand just this way or move their shoulder just this way, right? We know too much. Now, that's the first reason. Second reason for ineffective communication, might surprise you, is that we follow the golden rule. Now, I have no doubt most of you can state the golden rule. Treat others the way you would want to be treated. We've been taught this for years. It's, you know, the best approach for kindness and consideration. But I would argue this is probably the central issue in communication today. It's that we are following the golden rule. And what do I mean by this? We tend to communicate and relay concepts to others the same way we want to retrieve information or take in information. So if I'm a real data junkie and I need to see the stats and the detail, the minutia behind it, I'm definitely more likely to communicate in that same way to others, even if that's not their learning style, even if that's not how they take in the information. So, you know, they might need something more visual than what we would need, but we often use the golden rule. And I'm going to challenge us, instead of using the golden rule, to use the platinum rule. The platinum rule is to treat others the way they want to be treated. Now, you ask the question, how do I do this? You are going to have to know what that other person needs in this moment. You're going to have to figure out how to make it meaningful to them. And I'll share some tools with you to do exactly that in the next section. So first, we know too much. Second, we treat others the way we want to be treated. Can't do that anymore, right? We're going to treat them the way they want to be treated. And the third reason for ineffective communication, and this isn't all of them, but these are three really big ones, is that we want people to think we're competent. And there's nothing wrong with this. This is natural for all of us, whether it's our boss or our colleagues, board of directors, fellow researchers. We obviously want people to think we're credible and we're competent. We're doing good work. What does that mean? It means that we often try to demonstrate that competence by using jargon or using big language, complex language. I'm a culprit of it myself. You've probably heard me say some big words thus far. I need to adjust that. So we need to be careful when we're using jargon or big words to communicate, because others may not understand and we're really excluding them in being able to access this information. It does nothing for their comprehension for us to use jargon. There was actually a recent article that poked fun at this. They stated that, bear with me, non-essential terminology is ubiquitous among enterprise paradigms. In real simple language, business jargon is overused. That's what that means. So let's use the simple terms. Scientific jargon is also overused, and it's actually on the rise. So there was a study completed over in the UK, and they looked at research articles for the last 100 years. And over time, what they could easily see is that the readability of scientific texts and articles is decreasing over time. We are less likely to be able to understand what we read today versus 10 years ago versus 10 years before that. Now, sure, we have a deeper knowledge of each of these topics, and so maybe we're using language that's a little more specific, a little more accurate, but we're making it harder for people to understand it. And the concern here is that when we make it less accessible to the general public, those are the people we actually need to act on the data or support the data. So three main issues here. So we really want to avoid jargon, keep it simple. For any literature buffs in the crowd, George Orwell wrote a brilliant essay called Politics in the English Language. And in that essay, he kind of calls out most of the speeches that are given today, most of the written language you see in leadership and business. And he says, look, they're all ineffective. The point of his essay, never use a fancy word when a simple one will do. So remember that as we move through this. Okay, so three main barriers we've talked about to effective communication. We know too much, right? That leads us to make assumptions. We treat others the way we want to be treated. That leads us down the wrong path in communication. And we want to appear competent. So we sometimes make it harder for others to take in our info. So what I want to talk about next are three considerations as you're in preparation mode for communicating, three things you really want to take into account. The first is probably the single most important thing we can do as we're preparing to communicate, and that's to connect with our audience, to connect with the people who are going to receive that information. What do I mean by that? Well, it's about putting ourselves in their shoes. It's about connecting our message with what's important to them. How do they benefit? Why should they care? It's also our ability to read their body language, their micro expressions, those tiny, barely noticeable movements in their face to gauge whether or not they're following us. So this empathy piece, this putting ourselves in their shoes, is the single most important factor in developing great communication. Okay, and I'm going to give you a couple of things to think about for empathy. So here's the first. What are you going to do to put yourself in their shoes? You're going to ask yourself a few quick questions as you're preparing. Who am I speaking with? Who is this audience? You saw it in the most recent video we watched on blog posts. Same thing. Who's the audience for this? What do they already know about this subject? What do they already know about this subject? It may be nothing. But try and gauge, ask yourself the question, what do they need to know? Not what is everything you could possibly tell them. What do they need to know? What are the gaps I need to fill in for them along the way? So if they need to know A and D, are there some gaps between that I need to just give them some clarity and context so that they get to the points with me, right? And finally, how far should I go? So again, this is about gauging how much can I give them. And again, I'll give you a few more tips on this as we move forward. But I would say when you're starting to prepare communication, ask yourself these questions. You have access to these slides, but you could certainly take a photo of this if you'd like. So put yourself in their shoes. It will help you know where to start, where to end, how far to go. Just meet them where they are. And you know, for all of his criticism, I would say Steve Jobs always did a really brilliant job of putting himself in the shoes of his customer. When he introduced the iPod, which I know seems like 30 years ago, I don't know, it seems like forever ago, he could have spent time, like all of the other tech companies, talking about gigabytes and 3G and interface. That's the language he could have used. Instead, do you know what he said? He said, this is a small box that will allow you to carry 1,000 of your favorite songs in your pocket everywhere you go. That's how simple he made this. He distilled it down to one extremely understandable piece of information that really benefited the listener. And I think that's really amazing. He also kind of left them wanting more. So if we can get to a place where the person has learned, they understood, they wanted to listen, and they wanted to learn more, we're in a great spot. So how are we in the sport community stripping our language down to really simple words, simple concepts that the audience can understand in a way that highlights how they'll benefit. That's our challenge. That's our task at hand. Now, one of the other really important components of kind of empathy and putting yourself in their shoes that I'll reference quickly, and then we'll move to number two, is that great communicators are often also great listeners. And so learning how to listen is a really important skill for all of us as part of our communication. Listening with our eyes and our ears, listening to what's not being said. I'll give you a little tip. I used to ask the question in workshops, does anyone have any questions? I have changed that question. Now I say, what questions do you have? I'm going to force those questions out. I know you have them. Tell me what they are. So just some of those small language shifts will help that listening and communication piece. Look at the nonverbal. Are they following, right? Are they following? How is your nonverbal? Are you communicating with enthusiasm, with a smile? That's also really important in getting your message across. So for those of you who want to dive into listening a little bit more, because I won't cover too much here today, I will direct you to a great TED Talk by Julian Treasure. And his TED Talk is called 5 Ways to Listen Better. He gives us this great acronym, RASA. Receive the information, you know, pay attention to what's being said, appreciate it, thank them for it, summarize what you heard. This is also a tool you can use with someone who's listening to you. Get them to repeat what they heard and ask questions. So I'll let you play with listening, but that first piece is really about how do we build a connection with our audience, okay? Empathy, listening, those are the skills we need to pay attention to. Second consideration I want you to think about, and some of you may know Alan Alda from MASH, pretty great career history he has had. And maybe I'm showing my age, knowing Alan Alda. But what's interesting, so although he's an actor and a comedian and an author, what he's done really for the latter part of his career is help people improve their communication skills. So he's the founder of the Alan Alda Center for Communicating Science. And there he spends time connecting scientists with data and the general public. And so really interesting. Now, he totally believes in this notion of connecting with your audience, but he has a suggestion for us. And that is to use the rule of three. In your communication, make no more than 3 points, tell them 3 different ways, and repeat them 3 times. You'll follow with me, you'll see I repeat what we've discussed multiple times. Gives your brain a little bit of time to digest, if that makes sense. It's also why I broke this presentation out into 3 parts with 3 points in each part. A little easier for us to digest. So this is the second thing to consider. Third thing, which relates exactly to it, is the notion of chunking, which some of you, if you're teaching, may have heard of this concept of chunking. And it's really about communicating information in small, digestible parts. So our working memory, how our brain is working right now to remember what you're learning, what you're all doing right now, it has limited capacity. So if your listener, if their working memory is full because you've shared too much with them, then that excess information that you're sharing just drops out, disappears. They can't remember it. So chunking the content from one big long thing to many smaller parts will also help. You may take the results of a research study and decide that within it, you're not going to put out one communication that tells everything you learned. You're going to put out 3 that are going to give bite-sized informations. Right? And we've seen this with CERC as well. They've done a brilliant job with those bite-sized knowledge nuggets. So that's fantastic. I want to show you a couple of examples. If I were to give you this number and say, memorize this, and we'll talk about it a little bit later, a little hard for you to do. Trying to remember 11 digits is a challenge. But if I chunk it for you, which is precisely why phone numbers are chunked, then you have a much more, much greater chance of remembering it. Same thing would go for this many, many letters. If I said to you, please memorize this list of letters, difficult for you to do, but what if I simply spaced them apart and put them in acronyms you already know? A little bit easier. Let me make it chunk it one step further and put it into actual categories: animals, businesses, and alphabet. You have a much better chance of putting this into your working memory and storing it in this context, right? So this is really three considerations as you move through your communication. You want to connect with your audience, understand them, understand what they know. You want to use the count of threes, as per Alan Alda, and you want to chunk it out. Make it easy for your learner, right? Now, so we've looked at why communication is hard. We've looked at what we might think about as we're preparing. I want to give you three specific tools you can use to help make your communication a little more effective. And sometimes this is fun. Get a few people together and see what you can come up with. Tool number one, it's called 1713. So you've likely heard someone tell you to pretend you're explaining it to your mom, right? Take this complex idea and explain it to your mom. That'll bring it down for you. We're not giving moms nearly enough credit. Okay, let's just say that. So I prefer to say, let's explain it to someone from 1713. What language could we use that they would understand? So, you know, if we wanted to explain, say, the game of tennis to someone from 1713, would we say, tennis is a sport that is played against an opponent where each player uses a racket to strike a ball over a net and into the opponent's court. And the object of the game is to maneuver the ball in such a way that the opponent is not able to play a valid return. I suspect that's probably not how we would articulate it because we don't know if they understand what sport looks like, what a court means, valid return. But we might say something like, it's two people standing at opposite ends of a box that's drawn on the ground, and they hit a rubber ball back and forth using a stick. The goal is to try and make your opponent miss the ball. So there's no need for us to go to the complex language, even for someone today. But this exercise of explaining it to someone from 1713 really takes us down to the bare elements and forces us out of that mindset of we know too much, right? It takes us way down there. So I think that's a good opportunity, a good tool for us to use. You know, Bill Gates once said, if you can't explain something simply, you don't really understand it. So let's challenge ourselves on that. Okay, this next tool is unequivocally my favorite. I'm just going to tell you now, some of you may be familiar with this. It's called the Upgoer 5. The Upgoer 5, also known as Saturn V rocket. So back in 2012, a guy by the name of Randall Monroe, who's a graphic illustrator, he does comic books, and he has a web comic called XKCD, and they published, as part of their comic, a description of the Saturn V rocket. However, only using the 1,000 most frequent words in English. Rocket is not one of those. Saturn is not one of those. So they called it the Upgoer 5. And they also named things like the command, the control where all the leaders sit to make sure the spaceship goes in the right place. They called that the people box. The liquid hydrogen feed line became the thing that lets in cold, wet air to burn. So this is what he described. And there was a geneticist, Theo Anderson, who was so inspired by this. He thought this was so cool. He's really passionate about making science accessible to all. So here's what he did. He built a text editor that would force the user to write with only those 1,000 most frequent words in English. And they had to describe, whether you were a scientist, an economist, you had to describe what you did in this text editor that would only give you access to those 1,000 words. I'm going to give you an example. I want you to close your eyes as I read this out. I'm going to explain political economy to you as it is often explained on websites. Okay, are you ready for this? Listen carefully. Political economy is the study of production and trade and their relation with law, custom and government, and with the distribution of national income and wealth. How many of you did I lose? A fair number, right? I'm asleep. So they challenge this gentleman, Warren Durrett, he's a political economist, to explain what he does using this text editor, the Upgoer 5. And here's what he came up with. I try to see if bad people with power let bad people in business do bad things for easy money. And I also try to see if this hurts good people and their money. Okay, I understand that. I get that. Let me give you one more. Biological anthropology, as explained in Upgoer 5, I study old human stuff. We look at the old stuff to see when and where humans came from and why we look and act so funny instead of acting like other animals. Okay, I listened, I understand, and I'm interested. I'm going to call that a triple win in communication. I'm going to give you one last example. And this isn't using the Upgoer 5, but you'll be surprised how they got to this. So the Doppler effect. Doppler effect, scientifically, would be described as the change in frequency of a wave in relation to an observer who is moving relative to the wave source. Okay, I have to unpack that. Don't worry, I've got an easier one for you. We could use the Doppler effect is the change in how moving things sound. This happens when you hear an ambulance pass. It sounds one way when it is coming towards you, and it sounds different when it passes. This is because when a noisy thing moves, the sound waves around it are pushed together in front of it and stretched apart behind it. Do you know where this explanation came from? It came from a baby book called The ABCs of Science by Chris Ferry. I think, quite frankly, this is the kind of language we should be using in high school textbooks as well. So Upgoer 5, I want you to think in the future, how can you Upgoer 5 your communication? Okay, so we've looked at 1713 as a tool. We've looked at Upgoer 5. And the third and final was touched on by Bob in his section. So works out really well. It's really about painting the picture for the audience. Take them out of the language and paint the picture for them. So let me start with analogies. Analogies are just comparisons that give people a framework they can use to understand new information, right? How do we anchor against something they already know to help them understand something new? An analogy would be, you know, finding the keys in my purse is like finding a needle in a haystack. That would be an analogy. I think this is a great recent example of using an analogy to make a point. Why you should wear face masks, but described as a urine situation, right? The urine test. If we all run around naked and someone pees on you, you get wet right away. If you are wearing pants, some pee will get through, but not as much, so you're better protected. If the guy who pees also wears pants, the pee stays with him and you do not get wet. They were able to communicate a pretty difficult topic without the need to say things like droplets or airborne transmission. This is pretty obvious, pretty easy to get because they've framed it, wrapped it within an analogy. So consider an analogy when you are trying to explain something complex. For those of you who attended the storytelling workshop a couple weeks ago through SCRI, you'll know that stories engage our brains in a way that increases interest, increases my engagement in what you're telling me, and actually makes me want to do something for you. There's like this reciprocity when you tell a story that I want to do something for you in that moment. So we want to make sure that we're either wrapping in an analogy, wrapping in a story. Stories are actually 22 times more memorable than simply stating a fact. So find a way to share the information in a story format. And then the third piece in painting this overall picture is, you know, tough to get an actual firm stat on this, but we believe that there's roughly 65% of the population that are visual learners. So they're not auditory learners listening to learn. They're not kinesthetic learners physically learning, right? Moving around. They're visual learners. So maybe we take something that is complex to explain in words, and we put it in diagram format. Now, I'm not suggesting this is the perfect golf swing. I just thought this was a good representation for how we might take something that we thought we needed to write out in paragraphs, but could actually demonstrate it in images instead. Not only is that better for many, over half of the population for receiving the information, but it's likely something that gets you out of your head as this expert who feels the need to use jargon, big words, and lots of text. So those are three tools that you can use for getting to better communication. 1713, Upgoer 5, and Paint a Picture. Now, my question for you right now, because I've given you lots of homework, lots of things to think about at least, is why do we bother? Why should we bother? Shouldn't the listener be responsible for understanding what we're telling them? Well, I'll point out the 8-second attention span that was mentioned earlier. That's good reason for us to work at this. But I think more importantly is that if people can't understand what we're saying, they can't join us. They can't support us. They can't act on what we want them to act on. So it's a tough scenario if we haven't gone through these steps to make sure we're really clear with people.